Farm. Family. Community. This is Midwest Farm Weekly.
Good morning, I'm Caitlin Corbett. Mullane has the week off, and welcome to Midwest Farm Weekly. On the show today, Focus on Energy marks 20 years of helping people live a greener life and save money. We have some tips to reduce your energy use. Their farm did great at the recent Forage Super Bowl. Now we get some tips and a look ahead to some rising stars and techniques, plus your extended forecast to finish fall field work. Well, the extra long growing season ended in northern areas of the Badger State after the region experienced its first killing frost. Wisconsin's weekly crop report also noticed that dry weather allowed many farmers to finish their fall harvest activity. Silage is nearly finished for the season. Corn for grain is around 50% harvested. Nearly three quarters of all of the soybeans have been run through the combines, and that's actually 5 days behind the 2020 crop year, but nearly a week ahead of normal. Higher prices at the grocery are likely coming our way. Experts say the supply chain disruptions are to blame, but it isn't just consumers bearing the brunt. Costs are also rising for farmers.
This is gonna grow up and outcompete the weeds next year.
Josh Cox is a seventh generation farmer at Wildcat Valley Farms.
We raise corn, soybeans, wheat.
Herbicide shortages are already making next year's growing season challenging for Josh and 90,000 other Hoosier farmers.
The prices have tripled in cost. Fertilizers are in the same boat. They have increased probably 4 to 5 times the price of what the herbicides have.
Because of supply chain issues and the pandemic, we're seeing a shortage in the most common herbicides that we use in corn and soybean production.
Bill Johnson, a professor of weed science at Purdue University, says two of the most widely used active ingredients, glyphosate and glyphosinate, are in short supply, driving the price for farmers up.
And if we're spending more on our inputs, like herbicides, that results in a lot of income that is not realized by the farmers in our state.
Which translates to higher prices at the grocery store and lower incomes in areas heavily impacted by farm income.
Much of the corn and soybeans that are produced in the state are fed to livestock, so certainly we'll see a higher cost of meat products and then other products that use things that are made from corn and soybeans.
Farmers say there are alternatives to the ingredients, but they aren't as effective and can take more skill to apply.
I think there's some ways we can manage it. It's just going to be getting outside of our comfort zone.
But Josh says he'll do what needs to be done to keep business as usual.
Maybe things will come around, herbicide will start showing up, and it won't be a major issue.
Your help is needed this fall to control the gypsy moth population. The DNR is asking for people to look for and dispose of egg masses if they find them. Gypsy moths are an invasive pest that lay egg masses that are tan-colored lumps about the size of a nickel or a quarter. Each mass contains hundreds of eggs, and they can be found on trees, buildings, and other outdoor objects, including firewood piles and birdhouses. Left untreated, the moths can damage and even kill trees. Well, as we head into the holiday season, meat prices continue to climb. Experts say they're up around 16% in the last 2 years, but could jump another 6% before year's end. Price aside, will supplies hold up for family gatherings? Trucking and processing shortages mean the turkeys are spending more time on the farm. There are plenty of birds to go around, but you might not have a wide variety of sizes.
There will not be a shortage of turkey this year. It will be perhaps when you go to the store, you won't find the exact size you want. Bigger is better, right? This is America, so get a big one.
And to catch up, many processing plants are running for an extra day. Well, another supply chain bottleneck is affecting local beer and winemakers. This shortage can affect your wallet and your tailgate party, and it may go even further than that. Breweries and wineries in the La Crosse area are feeling the supply shortages of glass bottles and aluminum cans, which are raising prices and stifling production.
From vineyard to table, El Maro Vineyard in Trempolo takes pride in its acres of grapes.
The romance of it is fun. Seeing the people, I enjoy seeing people, the guests, the people that play musical instruments here. It's fun. That part's fun.
But a bottle shortage is upsetting the flow.
Every day can be a challenge, which is normal for this business. It's not unusual for it to be a challenge. It's just adding more weight
Competition for its main supplier in Mexico and shipping backups have raised bottle prices and made it tougher for small wineries like El Morro to keep up.
Every winery in the world is feeling the shortage. I don't believe it's just us. We feel it rather hard because we're a small winery in the full winery's picture.
And glass bottles aren't the only thing coming up short. At Pearl Street Brewery in La Crosse, they're short on cans.
Last year we got a canning line in 2020, and that was right about the time the aluminum shortage happened.
That shortage made founder Joe Kachiever's supplier unable to fulfill its canning contract.
Cans we are able to source are all, you know, very high quality, just as good, but they're coming from overseas as opposed to domestic cans. So it's really hard to find American-made cans, which we would prefer to use.
Raising prices and pressure on suppliers along the chain as the shortage goes on.
The real issue here is the unknowns, not knowing what, you know, the future looks like.